After a decade of dominance by Cristiano Ronaldo and Lionel Messi, many players were left feeling cheated of their chance at a Ballon d'Or. After all, competing with superhumans like these two shouldn't be expected from anyone. But every once in a while, there were some players who nearly snatched the prize, and one rises above all as the main contender for this impressive accomplishment. His name is Wesley Sneijder. And today I'm gonna tell you why many people think that at a certain point in time he was a better player than Lionel Messi, and how he still managed to somehow not get a spot at the podium of the Ballon d'Or. It all started in Utrecht, land of the mighty Marco van Basten. Sneijder was born into what you might simply call a football family. Everyone was into the sport and everyone had always shown significant talents. As he grew up, he heard a lot of stories of football dreams and aspirations, maybe from his grandfather who represented several Dutch clubs, or from his older brother who eventually would join the Ajax youth team. From early on, Sneijder took on youth level football, playing for a local club DOS, part of the conglomerate that formed FC Utrecht. As one might imagine, given how silky smooth his touch was, Sneijder was a natural born talent and would at the age of 7 start giving the first signs that he would outshine every one of the family's other talents, as he would be given a trial at Ajax, which he would absolutely excel in, so much so that he would immediately be signed on a permanent basis. From here on it was smooth sailing, until in 2002 at 18 years of age his youth level coach and former European champion Danny Blind would tell main coach Ronald Koeman, who was being haunted by the first team's injury problems, that it was perhaps time to call up Sneijder, and so he did. And even though Sneijder would spend the whole match on the bench, he would keep training with the main team, and by February he would get his debut. By April, he had cemented his place enough to be a part of the starting 11 in a Champions League knockout match against AC Milan. His presence was great help to this struggling squad, managing to lead them to a 9-game winning streak at the end of the season, which nearly led them to closing up an 8-point gap behind first place PSV, though not quite, as a single point would stop Sneijder from winning the Eredivisie in his first season. Ajax had a very young squad, with perhaps the exception of a 33-year-old Jari Litmanen, who despite struggling with his fitness surely didn't struggle to pass down a knowledge he had to the impressive trio of Sneijder, Van der Vaart and Zlatan Ibrahimovic. The three of them were just something else. This is a truly underrated squad that honestly could have achieved much more, and though on this second season they did get the Eredivisie title, leading Sneijder to get the award for the best young player in the league. But then, they wouldn't get to win much else as Ibrahimovic left for Juventus. Knowing how underwhelming Ibra's time at Juve was, it's hard not to feel sad by the thought of what could have been had he stayed in Amsterdam. In the summer of 2004, Sneijder got to play his first ever international tournament with the Netherlands. Though he would only get to play 58 minutes before the national team crashed out of the tournament against hosts Portugal. Following the departure of Ibrahimovic, Ajax failed to win the league and Van der Vaart would follow suit, leaving to play in the Bundesliga with Hamburg, leaving Sneijder with a much more unimpressive squad that would disappoint, finishing 4th in the league. At this point it must have been worrying for Sneijder. In a way it might have seemed like he missed the opportunity to take the jump onto one of the top 5 leagues. If at first it felt like he was part of an exciting new project, now it seemed like he was just one more element of a decaying squad. Regardless, after the club season ended, there was reason to be hopeful as Sneijder would be called up to play his first ever World Cup with the Netherlands national team. We would get the first few sightings of his partnership with Arjen Robben, but it would end sooner than expected as the Netherlands came out in the losing side of the Battle of Nuremberg, a famous match against Portugal in which 16 yellows and 4 reds were awarded by the referee. Back at Ajax it was time for a revolution and thankfully it came. Veterans Jaap Stam and Edgar Davids joined the squad, which followed by the blossoming of young talents like Vermaelen, Vertonghen and Untelaar seemed to be enough to help Sneijder send Ajax back to the top. And so came Sneijder's best season to date. His goal scoring numbers started skyrocketing, his greatest performances coming one after the other, at a certain point even getting a hat-trick against rivals Feyenoord. Still, PSV was in front, but Sneijder kept pushing, and as the season ended, and Sneijder totaled 28 goals and assists in 30 league matches, Ajax were now tied in points for the first place. Though PSV would still take home the trophy on goal difference. A very disappointing outcome to an otherwise incredible season by Sneijder, but still, it had been enough to win over the European crowds, and now, his big break was coming. Fabio Capello had left Real Madrid, and Schuster, who had already signed two Dutch players, Drenthe and Arjen Robben, was looking to add another one to the list, so why not go for Robben's promising national team partner, right? So they did, and Sneijder moved to Madrid, taking over David Beckham's number 23. His start would be impressive, playing the Madrid derby as his first ever La Liga match and getting the winning goal. The following two matches would see him getting 3 goals, though this wouldn't be indicative of the rest of the season. From here on, his form dropped, though he was still playing fairly well, ending his first La Liga season with 16 goals and assists in 30 matches, despite rarely playing the full 90 minutes. To further push the narrative that this was a successful debut season, Real Madrid retained the La Liga title. Over summer, as Sneijder joined the Netherlands national team once more, he got a serious trial by fire, drawing the group of death containing both France and Italy. If there was ever a stage where Sneijder could prove he was a world-class talent, this was it. And he didn't disappoint one bit, getting a goal and an assist against Italy before providing France with the same treatment. His teammates weren't looking too shabby either, and the world held its breath as it looked as if the Netherlands were about to conquer it. But then, a shocking upset as they faced Russia in the last 16 would ruin their tournament. Still, Sneijder would provide the assist that would get them to a fruitless extra time, his fifth goal contribution in the 3 matches he got to play. The following season should have been big for Sneijder. Rubinho left and he took over the number 10 shirt, Van der Vaart and Huntelaar came to join him, but a preseason injury would leave him out for a few months, and as he came back, he would struggle to get minutes, eventually being sold to Inter Milan for 15 million euros, way less than the 27 Madrid had just paid for him. He would struggle with Italian football, his numbers would remain lower than what he had previously proved to be capable of. But in the Champions League, it was a whole different story. This Inter was being coached by José Mourinho, who had won the Champions League with Porto but failed to conquer Europe's biggest trophy during his time at Chelsea. So now, in order to maintain his reputation as Europe's brightest new manager, he had to pull off the impossible and win it with Inter for the first time in 55 years, and the signing of Sneijder would be the final piece of the puzzle. In the group stage, his numbers weren't that impressive, to be fair. He wouldn't be available for 2 of the 6 matches and wouldn't be able to capitalize on any chances against Barcelona or Rubin Kazan. Though, to be fair, he did get 1 goal and 2 assists against Dynamo Kiev. But once the knockout stage matches started, the Champions League anthem must have awakened something inside him, because Sneijder started firing like very few are capable of, and Inter became nearly unstoppable. First came Chelsea, and though the first leg wouldn't see Sneijder get his name on a score sheet, once they left for Stamford Bridge, Sneijder would assist the only goal of the match with a perfectly weighted pass that would seal their place in the quarterfinals. A favorable draw would see Inter get matched up with CSKA Moscow, but if it seemed easy, it certainly proved much more difficult than expected. We would only get to see 1 goal in each leg, with Sneijder being all over the tie, assisting 1 goal and scoring the other. The semi-finals would actually turn out as the most iconic match. Mourinho met Guardiola, Inter met perhaps the greatest squad ever assembled. Most people back then thought Barcelona were truly unbeatable, literally that simple. And even though some people might have had hopes that Mourinho would pull off the impossible, once the game started, it wouldn't be too long before Barcelona went in front. Maxwell, who had just left Inter, would assist the goal, making it that much better. But then, it suddenly started. 11 minutes later, Pandev would drag Dani Alves towards the center of the box, and Sneijder would show up out wide and bang it in to draw the match. The second half would shockingly bring 2 more goals for Inter, with Sneijder accidentally assisting Milito through a misplaced header. This was all fun and games, but there would be a second leg, and Barcelona certainly weren't messing around anymore. When Thiago Motta got the red card at the 28th minute, it seemed like a death sentence. but there was a time when Mourinho could hold a result like no other coach. And so it began. Guardiola's tiki-taka seemed hopeful, but Inter played the rest of the match with one goal: to make sure there wouldn't be a single meter of terrain not covered by a player in their defensive third. And it worked. Sure, it wasn't all a tactical masterclass, they did concede one and Julius Caesar was massive on goal, but Inter were in the final of the Champions League. They would face Bayern, Sneijder would face his national team partner Arjen Robben. It was a matchup between two titans, but Inter had so much momentum, there was really nothing that could be done. 35 minutes into the match, Sneijder got one more assist, putting Inter in front as they would eventually win by two goals and conquer not only the Champions League, but the treble as well. Milito was incredible, scoring against every team they faced in the knockout stages, and it would be easy to say that he was the star of the tournament on paper. But Sneijder had topped the assist charts, and in a way, if Milito had performed at that level, it was as much because of Sneijder as it was due to his own talent. This was already an unbelievable season that could easily warrant a player a spot in the Ballon d'Or podium, but then came the 2010 World Cup. The opening match would be against Denmark, and though he would fail to score a goal or record an assist, Sneijder would be awarded as man of the match. The second match would carry a lot more drama, as despite being heavy favourites, the Netherlands would struggle against Japan, only winning with a goal by, of course, Wesley Sneijder. The third group stage match would be a mere formality, and Sneijder would have a more quiet performance, though of course, once the knockout stage started and Netherlands saw what a tough opposition Slovakia could be, Sneijder would pull another man of the match performance and get a goal and an assist as they beat them 2-1. Then things got serious. It was time to play Brazil, and before the timer hit double digits, Rubinho had scored. But it was offside, so maybe they had a lifeline, but no. A few minutes later, Rubinho had scored again, this time a legal goal that confirmed it was about to be a tough night for the Dutch. The previous day, Sneijder had an interview. They asked him if Julius Caesar, who was the Brazilian goalkeeper and his teammate at Inter, of course, had any weaknesses. He said, "Not really, except perhaps high crosses. Sometimes he just misses the ball, so..." Guess what? Sneijder tested his theory, and now the Netherlands were tied. Just a few minutes later, Robben would hit a corner, and somehow, Sneijder, with his immense 170 centimeters, would get to the header and put it in. The Netherlands were in front, and they wouldn't let go of the lead. The semi-finals would be an interesting match as Sneijder put the Netherlands in front after Uruguay tied the match, as they would eventually win 3-2 and Sneijder would collect another Man of the Match award. And so, it was time for the final of the World Cup. Billions watching, but it wasn't those billions of eyes that scared Sneijder. It was the eyes of the seven Catalans we had defeated in the Champions League that were now staring at him from the other side of the pitch. It was a match fought long and hard, and by extra time, Heitinga got a red card and Spain took on the opportunity with Iniesta scoring the winner. Sneijder was one match short of having the most successful season of all time trophy-wise. When it was time to deliver the awards, despite his 5 goals, Sneijder would see Müller take the top scorer award due to his higher goal scoring frequency. Then, he would see the player of the tournament be given to Diego Forlan, who matched his tally in both goals and assists but failed to reach the final. Somehow, Sneijder came out of this tournament without any silverware to his name. But it was okay, the world knew he was the best player on earth at the moment, and he would get awarded for that eventually, right? Well, before the end of the year, and although Mourinho left Real Madrid, Sneijder added both the Club World Cup and the Italian Super Cup to his cabinet, totaling 5 trophies for the year. Though a defeat to Atletico in the European Super Cup made him only more bitter, as he wasn't able to clutch an historical 7 trophies in a season. Sneijder really needed to come clutch and get a good ending to this year, but without Mourinho by December, Inter were 10 points behind first place already, And when it was time to vote for the Ballon d'Or, it seemed the hype had died down and the voters were more interested in Messi's 27 goals in 21 matches since the beginning of the new season than in Sneijder's magical performances over the last months of the previous one. What upsets me the most is that Sneijder didn't even make the podium despite being named UEFA Midfielder of the Year. Two other midfielders, Xavi and Iniesta, got a place in the podium instead of him. I can guarantee you that in August of 2010, Wesley Sneijder was considered by many the best player in the world. But on the other hand, one thing is certain, Lionel Messi was Lionel Messi, perhaps the greatest of all time. This new season would end up being much worse than the previous one, with Inter finishing with only one trophy, the Coppa Italia. Sneijder would not have nearly as many iconic moments either, with the brightest of them coming as he helped Inter overturn a first-leg defeat to Bayern in the Champions League last 16. Sneijder had risen to the top in record time through his creativity, ability to place the perfect ball at the perfect time with either foot, through his mesmerizing technique, but now he was on a severe descent towards mediocrity, though I assure you that it will eventually be a twist. For the remainder of his time with Inter, it seemed he couldn't stop getting injured and Inter seemed unable to do it without him, so after 5 trophies in one season, Sneijder would not get his hands on any more silverware for the remainder of his time there. In 2 years, Sneijder would miss 51 matches due to injuries and Inter would propose that he reduced his salary from 14 to a mere 6 million. So, Sneijder pulled off the shocking decision of leaving the top 5 leagues at the age of 28, ending his contract and joining Galatasaray. Sneijder was, in a way, just hopeful of becoming a cult hero at Galatasaray. He seeked the love he had lost over the last few seasons, and what better place to feel the love of football fans than Turkey? Sneijder was lucky to join a side that had not only won the previous year's Turkish League, but also sat 5 points ahead of second place already for the current season. A month into his time there, he would inspire a comeback against Orduspor and start demonstrating the kind of leadership he could offer the club. Still, he wasn't the only legend at the club. He had to share the honor of that title with Didier Drogba. Together, they would inspire Galatasaray to an impressive Champions League run, beating Schalke and then winning the return leg against Real Madrid, scoring a goal each, though 3 goals by CR7 over both legs would lead them to exit the competition regardless. The following year, Sneijder would take on the role of vice-captain and he would hit some of the best form in a while, totaling 23 goals and assists in 34 matches at the domestic level. Though this time around Galatasaray would fail to win the league, in the Champions League they would manage some more iconic results, including a 1-0 win over Juventus with a single goal coming from Sneijder himself, as well as a draw in the first leg against Chelsea with Sneijder assisting their only goal. Regardless, Galatasaray would get one trophy as Sneijder scored the only goal in the final of the Turkish Cup, only made more impressive as he realized he also scored in both semi-final legs to help Galatasaray come from being behind 2 goals to win. Over summer, he would take part in his last ever international tournament, the 2014 World Cup, for which he would be named captain of the Dutch national team. In the opening match, the Dutch would destroy Spain 5-1 with Sneijder getting an assist. The remaining 2 matches would be more quiet, but the Dutch would easily make it into the last 16 where Mexico would nearly upset them with Huntelaar and Sneijder scoring in the dying minutes of the match to get them back on top. Then they would face Costa Rica, who would hold them to a goalless draw for 120 minutes, finally letting them get the win on penalties. Unfortunately, as Argentina took them down the same route, Sneijder would miss his penalty and see his national team get knocked out of the competition. If at this point there could be already an argument for Sneijder being a Galatasaray legend, the following season he would cement his place at the top. Galatasaray needed revenge, and as they met Fenerbahce in the league, they would go almost 90 minutes without either team scoring, and then Sneijder would just casually smash it in from 30 yards out. And if that wasn't enough, 2 minutes later he would get the ball in his own half, and he would keep going and going and going, and another shot from outside the box would put Galatasaray 2 goals in front. With the second being actually pretty important since Fenerbahce would still score in injury time. If you put the legendary Gheorghe Hagi to the side, it's very straightforward to say that Galatasaray had pretty much never had the luck of having such a world-class talent in their squad, so of course Sneijder had to win a place in their hearts. The rest of the season would be pretty incredible as well, with Sneijder contributing for 6 goals in 6 matches in the Turkish Cup as Galatasaray took the trophy once more, as well as 13 goals and assists as they reclaimed the league title from their rivals. The following season would be the worst from Sneijder's time in Turkey. Other world-class players joined the league like Samuel Eto'o and Mario Gomez, and with Sneijder's form declining either through new injuries that kept showing up or due to his decaying relationship with the board who fined him 2 million euros after he earned himself a second suspension in the season for his 11th yellow card in 25 matches. This got very serious to the point of his agent accusing the club of trying to push away Sneijder. Regardless, he persisted, and in the following season he performed to excellence, topping the league's assist charts with a total of 15, though the club would still only manage a 4th place finish. Impressively, on the Christmas Day of 2016, he put on his best Santa Claus impression, gifting his teammates 3 assists in a single match. By the end of the season, he would decide to buy himself out of his contract, joining Nice for a while, playing only 8 matches for the club before leaving once more and joining Al Gharafa in Qatar. There he showed that he was clearly hanging his boots way too soon, as he would average around a goal or assist per match played, which would lead him to win his last ever trophy, the Qatari Cup, in 2018. Once his final act came to an end, many European football fans talked about how much of a waste it was that he left for Turkey so young, but those comments were merely a droplet in the ocean of Turkish fans who thanked Sneijder for the moments of magic he brought them. If there was ever any doubt, now there was none. Sneijder was not just a Galatasaray legend, he was one of the greatest cult heroes in the history of the Turkish league. He would also end his international career as the player with the most ever caps for the Dutch national team. And on that note, let's get into the ranking system. Finishing is an 8. It was impressive, especially from dead balls and long range. Playmaking is a 10 out of 10. He was quite simply one of the best playmakers of his time. Dribbling is a 9. I considered a 10, but I think he comes a bit short of that. Speed and physicality is a 7, he was short and very lightweight, but he was still impressive in close physical battles. Mentality is an 8 out of 10, my first thought was that he deserved a 10. He was a big game player, truly exceptional when it mattered the most, but he was also substantially undisciplined and not the hardest worker on the pitch at all, so I guess it is what it is. Longevity and adaptability is an 8 out of 10, he easily adapted to every scenario you threw at him, but his career wasn't the longest at all, so it's kind of a mixed bag. Flair is easy, a 10 out of 10, always a pleasure to watch. Trophy cabinet is a 7 out of 10, he won a lot of domestic trophies in a lot of different leagues, but only a Champions League as a major trophy and no Ballon d'Or makes it a tough case. Finally, icon factor, an 8 out of 10 sounds about right, so this totals out to 75 out of 90, placing him level with Pirlo and Henry. Now, all you gotta do is go to the link in the description and vote for whether you think this man was a legend or not, so you can influence the ranking and maybe get him a few places up. So yeah, this is it for today. I'd like to mention that I forgot to add the link to Yari Litmanen's X Factor at first, so that's why I haven't told you are we ranked yet. But yeah, I hope you enjoyed. If you did, don't forget to like and subscribe. This was Wesley Sneijder's career in a video. I'll see you next time. Bye.